Hello and welcome back to The Simple Game Dev. My name is Remy Storms, and since I haven't had my cup of coffee this morning, we're gonna try to keep this video as quick, concise, and simple as possible. So we're gonna start where we left off that past video, and what we had done was a little bit of the surprise box prefab and some scripting, right? So if you don't have your surprise box prefab here for some reason, don't worry. I'm sure you have it somewhere in your prefabs folder. If you have been following along, that's why it's good to have good naming conventions and put everything on different folders. So just grab your surprise box prefab, and inside of it, you should see the surprise box script. If not, it should be under scripts as well. So let's double click on it to open it. Give a second. There it is. And the only thing that we added last time was a couple of variables that I'm sure we're going to be using. And then I put some comments to show what the game was going to be doing, right? But if you remember the design Photoshop document that we have, what the box is going to be doing is basically appearing, moving, and waiting for X amount of time. Now, we could do everything like this on start. However, since we need to have certain time to wait before doing things, what we're going to do today is called coroutines. And in order to make a coroutine, we type in iEnumerator, and it's just like making any other function, I guess. You call it whatever you want to call it. In this case, I guess I'm gonna call it box routine. And then I'm going to move every comment that I put on the start to the iEnumerator routine. Now, don't forget to save often. Now, let's start with the first point. Find wait and endpoint. So, in order to do that, there's a couple of ways we can do it. Since this is a simple game, and I'm not worried too much about performance, let's do it by actually finding it on the inspector. So, since we already have our middle position and end position transforms, so we're gonna use those ones. Middle position equals game object dot find, and then we just pass in the string for the name of the game object. And since those ones are already gonna be there when the scene loads, then that's gonna be fine. So we need to, okay, copy the wait point because that's the name. There you go. Oh, I didn't copy it. Oh, wait point. And then we also need to get a reference to end position game object dot find. Sorry, it's a capital game object dot find. And this one is called endpoint. Endpoint. There you go. Save. And a good practice is to, every time you do a couple of changes in your script, just play to see that you don't have any errors, just like in here. So let's see what that error is. Okay. Unity engine.gameObject cannot be transformed into unity.transform. That's, yeah, exactly. That means right now I said that the middle position and end positions are of a type transform. And here, this gameObject.find returns a type gameObject. So what we need to do is just look for the actual transform of that game object. And I'm pretty sure that will get rid of that error. Okay, so this one will get fixed in a second. Move towards a waypoint. Okay, that one is easy. But before that, let me show you what we need to do. In order to have kind of a waiting between, you know, steps inside the coroutines, we need to type in this. Yield return, you know, wait for seconds. And then you can pass on how many seconds you wanted to wait. Let's say 1 second, one float. And just so that you can see what's going on, I'm going to put a debug.log. Waiting time is over. So what's going to happen is that this box routine, as soon as it gets called, it's going to find those two transforms. Then it's going to wait for 1 second. And after that, it's going to log out this waiting time is over. That's it. So in order to test that, we need to, or this is how you call a call routine. Start coroutine, and then you pass the name of the coroutine, in this case box routine. Save it out, and this error should be gone. There you go. So let's try it out. If we check the box prefab, there is nothing on the middle position and end position. So let's play it out, and after a second of these two guys appearing, there's going to be a log. Give a second, it's not blue yet. There. And waiting time is over. I guess it was too fast. We can change it to 10 seconds. But look at this. Pay attention to the middle position and end position, because it's gonna, there you go. Waiting time is over. I'm not sure if it's actually waiting. So let's do this. Instead of debug, I'm just gonna destroy this game object so that I can know this is actually waiting the 10 seconds. Yield return, he waits for seconds, and then it will destroy the game object. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11. Well, yeah, it was. It's working as expected. So why was this doing that? I'm not sure. Oh, it wasn't even the debug from this one. It was an old one. So yeah, it's working just as expected. So let's continue doing our thing. I'm just gonna get rid of this code. Move towards waypoint. Remember that plugin that we downloaded, the iTween, where so this is where we are going to use it. And in order to do that, we need to call iTween dot, and the function we're going to use from iTween is going to be a move to. Now move to works. It takes a couple of parameters. It takes the game object, a game object that you need to move. In this case, is this dot game object, because this is the box that we're going to be using. And then iTween dot hash. Here we can have a little bit more, I guess, variable. No, not variables, but values that we can modify to have this. So one thing I always do when using iTween is just search for iTween on Google, because there's to be be honest, it's a pretty robust system. So just go to the documentation, and in our case, we are using the move to, and these are all the parameters that you can modify. So in this case, we are going to move to a position. So let's do that. Every parameter that you need to move, position. Here it tells you what exactly it is. Position is going to be a transform or a vector 3. So what I'm telling iTween right now is, okay, you're going to move this game object to a specific position. And we know that position is going to be the middle position, right? And since it's already a transform, it should be fine. So another thing we can specify is how long will it take to move from the current location to that point. You can do that by using the variable time, or if you want to modify speed instead, then you do that one. But let's do time. And since we already specified that we want the move time to be 1.5 seconds, we are going to use move time. I believe that's it for this iTween. Since we only want that to happen, right? We just want it to appear, find that position, and then move to that point. Then we wanted to wait for X amount of seconds before we put 10 seconds, but that was just a quick test. So instead of that, I'm gonna change this for wait time, so that we can just go into the actual game object and modify this public float instead of going inside the script. That's it. Animate to show its contents. Well, we won't do that in this video. However, we will do the move towards an endpoint. And we can just copy this one because it's pretty much the same. We are going to move this game object, the box, and we're gonna create another iTween hash table. The position, instead of being the middle position, is going to be end position. Time, it's going to be move time. And finally, we need to destroy this box. Destroy this dot game object. And we can also put a float value for a delay on maybe you don't want this box to be destroyed right away. Maybe we want it to destroy after 2 seconds or 1 second. So let's put 2 seconds there. 2F, because it's a float. Save it. And let's see if we have that right. We don't have any errors, but we're not sure that it's going to work right now. So let's play it. Book. So it moved there, and then it moved to the endpoint, and then it destroyed it. So perfect. That's exactly what we want. Right now, it did it like really quick and weird because it really didn't appear in the spawn point. So let's move this to the spawn point just to see how it might look. And I'm gonna take it out of the object book. So imagine that. There you go. Now, if you're not like super happy with it yet, we can add a little bit of awesomeness. Let me get rid of this surprise box and go back to the spawner. Now, the spawner, if you remember, we had some scripting before. Let's go to the spawner, box spawner. And let's create a simple tester, void update. It's gonna be on update because I wanna be able to call that spawn box every time I, let's say, press the space bar. So if input, and this is one of the things I do all the time, just having tests all over my scripts to make sure every step of the way works. So input if I can type, dot get key down, key code dot, let's say we want it to happen when the spacebar is pressed. And when that happens, we are going to spawn, okay. See why I need my coffee? Spawn box. There you go. Now it should work. And if the spawner has the surprise box, because that's what it needs, we just drag the surprise box prefab into surprise box. And the spawn point from the spawner, let's find it, spawn point. That's it. Those are all the variables that we need. And let's just save really quickly. Maybe I'm just gonna move these ones apart a little bit. Let's say -5 and 5 so that we can have more room. And remember, since we put a move time, doesn't matter how far they are, it will take that amount of time, in this case 1.5 seconds, to move from one point to the other. Now there are more parameters in the iTween, but for now we're gonna keep it simple. So let's play it and see if we press spacebar, then the box appears, then it moves, then it destroys. And if I keep pressing spacebar, it's doing the same thing. So that's pretty much for this video. As I mentioned before, this was gonna be a quick and simple one. So I hope you enjoyed it. And I'll see you on the next video. Thanks so much for watching.